How you get started with DevOps in government. I work for a Dutch government agency and we are trying to implement DevOps. And in my experience, every organization has some difficulties with implementing DevOps. But when you work for a risk-averse, process-oriented enterprise organization, then you have some extra challenges, then it's extra difficult. So I created a model about how we are implementing it, and I will share this model with you today. But first of all, let me introduce myself a little bit. My name is Mieke, I live in the Netherlands. I'm an independent consultant. I'm passionate about agile development, about DevOps, continuous delivery. And I especially like driving the change and managing all the challenges that are associated with implementing these approaches. And not only the technical, but also the cultural ones and the organizational ones. When I'm not at work, I like to spend time with my family. This is my son, Olaf, and I also like to be in the mountains in the summer for hiking and climbing, and in the winter for skiing. I work at UWV, and we are the Dutch government agency that is responsible for collection and payment of the social security benefits, and for helping unemployed people back to work. And it's our vision that people can function best in society when they can participate in it by working. And we also believe that society functions best when as many people as possible can participate in it by working. So what we do is we help unemployed people back to work. And if work is not possible for some reason, then we make sure that income is available quickly so that at least they can participate in society. Here are some figures about our organization. We are an autonomous administrative authority. We execute the Dutch social and labor policy. Our head office is situated in Amsterdam. I have about 18,000 colleagues. We have 6.9 million insured people. I heard that's almost half of the people that live in Moscow. But in the Netherlands, it's almost every Dutch adult, working adult. We have about 1.4 million benefit recipients. So these are the people that really rely on us. And that's quite a vulnerable group because they're not on our websites or our clients because they want to. They're our clients because they have to. They rely on us. Most of them don't have savings. So they live from paycheck to paycheck. Most of them not very tech savvy. And we are the linking pin between the Dutch government, the tax agency, the employers, the employees, and the unemployed people. So not the most typical DevOps organization. And to understand why we started it with DevOps, I will share a little bit of our history with you. In 2012, we had to change our websites due to new legislation. We had to enable our clients so that they could fill in forms, change their applications, change their details, and see all their information with us by themselves. Until then, we only had like a static website with some basic information, with the payment dates and some addresses of the district offices. But that was it. And then we had to change into a dynamic website with self-service portals and a major increase of usage. All those 1.4 million recipients. So that was quite a challenge, and we managed to do so in 1 year, which is actually quite fast for our organization. But we suffered some crashes, some small crashes, and we had some difficulty in updating our software. So at the end of the summer, that really collapsed, and it resulted in a major crash that lasted for several days. So our main website was unavailable for several days, and we didn't know the exact reason. We didn't know how to fix it. It was a major disaster and was all over the news in the Netherlands. And the only good thing, though, is that was our wake-up call. That was our urgency call that we really had to change something. we couldn't guarantee our three main KPIs, availability, performance, and stability. And it's not that we have a competitor or that we want to be better than another organization. We just want to be a reliable partner. We just want to be able to provide new functionality to our customers on a regular basis, without downtime, in a predictable way. So we really had to change something. We had to change our infrastructure and improve it. So that is actually the start of our DevOps journey. And now we're getting to the interesting part, the model. It's based on our own experience, but you might recognize some of the patterns for yourself. And yes, I'm also very curious about your feedback on this model. So please let me know afterwards. The first element is the strategy. You always have to start with the strategy. You have to visualize your goal and decide on your approach. And for us, our goal was that we wanted a deployment automation pipeline. We wanted to be able to provide new functionality to our customers without downtime in a predictable way. And you're probably all familiar with large IT projects, multi-year projects, several millions, and they often fail because they try too much at the same time, or they run over budget because they cannot make adjustments within the original business case. And we wanted to avoid that mistake. So we decided to start very small. Very small, very safe, with a small application without any risk, just to make first the technical proof and from then on expand. So start small, then you have to decide on where to start. And I checked within our organization at the different departments, and I checked which department was the most willing to change, the most eager to change, most open to change. And I ended up with the customer service division. And there we just chose a very easy mainstream technology application. It was just a .NET application, nothing fancy. And we first wanted to create a minimal viable product. Of course, we wanted a deployment automation pipeline, but we just started it very small for this application. And I tried to show that with this picture. If you think of a bridge heading towards another mountain, you probably have something more stable in mind. But for this experienced hiker, this rope perfectly fits the purpose. This is enough. And when you have just a small .NET application, you don't have to create the best, perfect deployment pipeline yet. Just start very, very small, only for that application. And then afterwards, of course, then expand. So you have to create a roadmap and make a plan, decide how you are going to approach and how you're going to go further. And since we are also a Prince 2 organization, I had to translate that into a project initiation document and created phases with milestones. And I tried to do it a bit in an agile way. I only described like the first phase very clearly and that scope. And all the things for later were still open for adjustments. And then it's also very important that you create feedback loops so that you can measure what you're doing, so you can measure your progress and your approach and you can adjust it. And the second element of the model is the communication. Communication is also, you have of course the daily communication with your team, like the daily stand-ups, but also the kickoffs for every application that we onboarded it. Every time we started with a new application, we first had a meeting with all the stakeholders to share our plans and to involve them. Then we had like weekly progress meetings and tried to keep them involved. And afterwards, we shared our results and had retrospectives. And sometimes we call them evaluations, which is almost the same, but evaluations sometimes was a more familiar word to them, instead of retrospectives. And the only goal is that you have to try to get everyone on board and try to let everyone contribute. And if someone has concerns, that you will notice that very early and that you can ask people to help you solve their concerns or actually try to solve them themselves. Well, that was too fast. The second part of communication is focuses on the results. You have to show the advantages of what you are doing. So try to make a dashboard on your progress. Management loves dashboards, then they can relate to it and they can see the advantages. And also I wrote, for example, after every onboarding of a new application to our deployment pipeline, I wrote an email to all our stakeholders to inform them that we onboarded that application, but also to emphasize what we learned. I could emphasize that we onboarded a new technology or a new stack or the first time compliant with the new security standards. And by that, you gain confidence and you trigger people to also join the deployment pipeline and they want to be part of it. And of course, there are also the business advantages and the financial advantages. I'll share a little bit more about them later in the presentation. But the purpose here is again just to create as many ambassadors as you can and to grow further. Once you have these two key elements in place, then you can focus on the three pillars of the organization, like the people, the process, and technology. And from the people, your own team are of course the most important ones, because they are the ones that really do the work. And we started with our own team. We created our own team instead of hiring some DevOps engineers that were already pros. We figured that they would probably be perceived as some DevOps rock stars and they would probably be too fast for our organization. So we created our own team, which is probably a little bit slower, but the advantage of that is that our organization could much easier identify with them. And it would help with the adaptation of the change. So we created motivated team. We started with agile mindset. We started with Scrum boards, everything. And that was quite fun, actually. Besides the team, you also have some other stakeholders that you have to pay attention to. And in a large enterprise organization, there are at least four groups that you have to involve. I've listed them here. First one is, of course, the steering committee. They are responsible for providing you the right resources, for helping you, giving you the time, the environment. So they are important. You have to involve them and let them help you. The second one is the architecture board. You cannot change anything in the infrastructure without explicit approval of the architects. So you have to let them contribute, let them ask them to write a project start architecture, ask them to help you adjust the technical handbook. Or they have to understand your plans and they have to approve your plans, because otherwise you won't be able to go further within your organization. The third group, security board, is getting more and more important. In the beginning, I felt that security board wasn't as important as I realized it later, because I thought that changing from manual to automation would have no impact on the security level. And I received a lot of questions in the beginning. and a lot of concerns of people about security, and I couldn't really convince them. So after a while, I changed my approach, and I asked the security board for advice. I asked them what we could improve, and we got a whole list, and we embraced all their concerns, and we implemented everything, and we made it as secure as we could. And after that, they audited our project and our approach, and there weren't any risks. We were the most secure part of the organization. So now it's very easy to convince people and to have them aboard. Our way of working is more secure than their old way of working. And the fourth person that you shouldn't forget about is someone from every department, someone who knows the people, someone who knows the other dependencies within that department, and that can help you getting the right people at the table. And by asking these people for help, they become ambassadors, because they feel that they can contribute to the change, and they're more open to changing than when you just do it with your own team. The second pillar is the process. When you start an innovative project, you will notice that the processes of your organization won't match with your innovative ideas. So you have to adjust some of them in order to to go further. So you have to, and there were like two processes that I really wanted to change. And one is based on collaboration. We are a siloed organization, and I wanted people to work together. And the second one is the change process, which is very strict and rigid at our place. And I wanted that to become easier. This was our first challenge. We are a siloed organization. We have software vendors contracted on the development environment. We ourselves work on the test environment, and we have a hosting partner, IBM, for all the work, for all the ops work, everything on acceptance and production. And when I started it, the dev guys weren't even supposed to talk to the ops guys. The only way they could communicate was through a request for change or through someone from our own company. And I figured, I cannot change this contract. I cannot change the fact that they all work at their own place and feel comfortable about it. But I can remove the walls a little bit. I can show them what is behind the wall. So I invited the developers and the ops guys to come over and work at our place. And I had to negotiate about that with the vendors. I had to negotiate about that within my own organization. We even had to move to another tower, another building, where we could sit together. And in the beginning, no one really liked it. No one saw any advantages in this, because now they were away from their own colleagues. And the only thing they had in common is that they were all forced by me to come and work together. But after a while, they saw the advantages. They started to communicate. They started to see what the next person in chain really needed. And they started to help each other. They started to see that we had the same goal. So it was, we became sort of an island. We were working in a different way than the rest of the organization. But we weren't siloed anymore. And the second challenge is our change process. This is our change process. Maybe you have similar processes in your own organization. If you want to change something on production, you have to announce it 42 days in advance. With the request for change, there are several quality gates. There's a large freeze period. And then if everything is all right, you're finally allowed to change something on production. And I figured that is not the way I want to work. First, I don't know what I'm going to do in 42 days. And second, or even more important, I felt like this was the complete opposite of what we were trying to achieve with our project. So I had to adjust it. And when the first time I asked the change manager to make an exception and to adjust his change process, he just smiled and he was like, no, if this way of working doesn't, if your way of working doesn't fit in this process, then you have to adjust your way of working. And I invited him to come over to my team, to be a part of the team, and created full transparency. I showed him what we were doing. I showed him that we had our own quality gates, that we tested everything, that it was secure, that we didn't take any risk, we didn't have any concessions on quality. And by that, I gained his trust, and he started to realize that what we were doing were more like technical improvements instead of new functionality. So he figured it would be all right to make an exception and to create an own process. So then we got our own process, and we were allowed to announce a change on production like 2 days in advance. And that was perfect for the beginning. So you really have to negotiate on your process. The third pillar is the technology. We have a very complex IT architecture. We have more than 200 applications. And since we are a siloed organization, an application can be built on different stacks. Some applications are built in 2018. Some are built in the 60s of the former century. We are the most visited government website in the Netherlands. And yeah, it's all very risk averse and a lot of legacy. So if you want to create a deployment automation pipeline, you have to work in all the areas, all the different areas, at the vendors, at IBM, at our own place. And then again, just start very simple with the minimal viable product, and from then on expand and try to get to the more elder, more difficult applications. When you've addressed all the pillars in the organization and you have your strategy and communication in place, then it's time to create results. And I've divided the results into three categories: the technical results, the business results, and policy. First, you have to start building technical confidence. Prove that this works. Show them what the advantages are. And in the beginning, no one really believed that this would be something for our organization. And we onboarded a couple of applications, and I created a report on incidents. And I could prove that the number of incidents diminished once an application used deployment automation. And by that, I could prove that the stability was higher once you automated it. And that gained confidence, gained technical confidence, but afterwards, of course, also organizational confidence. You also have very clear business benefits, and it helps if you can visualize them. So you have the improved quality, the better availability, but also our customer service division used to have 2 or 3 releases a year, and now they have bi-weekly releases. So that's a major improvement for them. And we also tried, we had to make an estimation of the financial benefits. We measured the time that we needed for a release and for installation and the number of people that we used. Afterwards we measured it again. And we had about 90% less, we needed about 90% less ops people to do exactly the same thing for a release. So that really convinced the people of also the financial benefits. And the third result might surprise you a little bit, but it's policy. The architecture board was very pleased about all the results, the technical results and the business results, and they declared a policy that every application with our company should use deployment automation. And that was a major accelerator, because until then, it was my scope, it was my project goal. And I could offer the departments that I would onboard their application. And afterwards, when it was policy, it was a shared responsibility. The departments should get deployment automation, so they came to us for help. They asked us instead of pull, they came push. And I also noticed that people in our organization tend to scare a little bit from innovation. And when they have to change something because of a policy, that is for them business as usual. Because we have changed legislation and changed policy every year. So they're more open to change to policy than to new stuff or innovation, technical improvement. So this really helped us. And then when you have your first results, then you're ready to accelerate and scale. And here again, try to use the strength of the organization to accelerate. And we did three major things to grow and mature further. We made a switch from doing everything ourselves to enabling teams more. Enabling them to do this themselves. I expanded my team with experienced people, and we created a center of excellence and an end user community so that people could help each other. We still onboard most of the applications ourselves, but we made a switch to help other people, and by that they feel like they own the change. We get more ambassadors. It's easier for them to adopt to the change. And we have like more parallel tracks. So sometimes that is a bit difficult for my team, because some applications they really onboard themselves, and for some applications they just give advice. They just offer support. But it helps with the overall adaptation. And it's more like a change to serving leadership. I added three people to my team, and as I said in the beginning, we chose to develop our own people. And the people I added to my team are probably also not the most typical ones. I added the most critical application engineer from the customer service division. I think that he asked questions for almost half a year in the beginning. And he raised his concerns, and he wasn't willing to collaborate. And every time he had some questions or some concerns that hampered our progress. And I couldn't convince him. The only thing I could do was show him everything and make him part of it. And we showed him everything, we explained him everything. And after 6 months, he knew exactly as much as we did. And after 6 months, he finally got it, and I finally realized, okay, this is an improvement, okay, this is cool, and he wanted to join it. And from our biggest criticaster, he became our biggest ambassador. And after that, I asked him to join our team, because I figured that guy can really help us with other applications, with other people that are new and that have concerns, because he understands their concerns. Sometimes when people express their concerns to me, I say that I understand the concerns, and I listen, but he really understands their concerns. And he speaks their language, so he was probably the best to help them. I also invited the lead developer from one of our toughest applications to join us. We have onboarded almost half of our applications, and there was one application that we started, but that we couldn't finish yet. Because it was too difficult, too many challenges, both technical and organizational. And we're trying to make a fresh start next year. But the developer that was on that track has learned so much. He has conquered and seen so many challenges and so many impediments that he knows, he's the most clever developer at our company. So I wanted him to join our team. Instead of he is the only one that didn't succeed. I figured, no, he's the hero. I want him on my team. And the third person is an enthusiastic trainee. No work experience, no clue about IT, 24 years old. And I figured she can help us with creating a center of excellence, creating a knowledge base. How can we help people with the knowledge? How can we? And she asks a lot of questions every day, so she helps us also questioning our own way of working and improving our team. So we are a very diverse team, and yeah, I'm also very proud of my team. And the third thing that we did to accelerate is that we started a center of excellence. We created an end user community. We have end user groups. We have now developers from one software vendor helping developers from another software vendor, sharing best practices. We have newsletters. We optimize our own way of working every day, and we still improve, we still innovate, we still push boundaries and try new things and learn every day. So that's the model, and we ourselves, we haven't finished our journey yet. We ourselves are in the outer circle, accelerate and scale. This is what we still have to do. We have to onboard the remaining applications, which is almost half of that, half of the infrastructure. I believe that we can still improve every day. I want to integrate with test automation, which is another project in our organization. And we'll get a new hosting partner. So we also have to make a switch to the new hosting partner and see how that works out. And I tried to visualize our end goal. We want to create a deployment pipeline where every application in our company can onboard, where every application can deploy automatically. And that is, of course, I want to finish the bridge. I want to finish the bridge so that everyone can walk that bridge towards the other side. And it's a very stable bridge. So to summarize, I have some advice. Create a cross-functional team with motivated and skilled members. And it doesn't matter if they don't have the skills yet. You can teach them everything and take the time and of your own organization. Create DevOps values and use DevOps techniques, even if your own organization isn't ready to call it DevOps yet, even if you work in a different way than the rest of the organization, that is normal with innovation. Build reliability, first focus on the technical confidence and then on the organizational confidence. Visualize your goal, visualize your results, measure everything and make reports or a dashboard. Show them the improvements. Keep learning and improving. Create flow. We have created the flow. We sometimes meet developers or with the new application. And when they have some concerns, they're like, yeah, okay, but our application is very different. And we're like, no, every application is possible to deploy automatically. You just have to create your own way of working and create flow. Use the strength of the organization, use the people, let them contribute. It helps you for the overall adaptation and it makes it all go faster. And celebrate your success. So these are my key takeaways. Thank you for your attention. I hope I inspired you to start your own DevOps journey or continue with your journey and keep the patience. I'll see if I have some questions on Slido. What were the criteria for choosing a product for minimal viable product? Well, it had to be mainstream technology. We chose for an application that didn't have direct contact with the customer. So if it would go wrong, it would only be our internal organization that would notice it, and was very small. Our first application didn't even have a database. So So we really started very small, and from then on expand and learned more. Can you show us the change process? Yes, it is almost the same process, it's just much shorter. We don't have a freeze period, and we don't have the quality gates that strict. So by now we even can announce that we want to change something on production tomorrow. And we have created our own request for change forms and introduced them to change management and to all the divisions. And since it's now policy that applications should have deployment automations, applications that already have deployment automation are rewarded by the faster change process. And one day before is not always necessary, it's not what they always need. So most of the divisions just choose for bi-weekly releases as a standard. What kind of role plays IBM in your company? IBM is our hosting partner, so they're the only ones that are allowed on acceptance and production, and they are responsible for maintaining our applications up and running. They're our ops organization. And in the beginning, they were they weren't very eager to help with this project, because they also feared for loss of their own revenue. I wanted to automate a lot of their work, but at the end they learned that it was actually a mutual goal, because it's their goal to provide good availability of the applications, and we also wanted to improve the availability. So this would actually help them, and by helping me with this project, they could prove that they are a reliable partner, that they are a flexible partner, and that only the gain, the euros, isn't their solid purpose. You move developers into your building from outsourced to outstaff. I don't know, what do you mean by outstaff? Whose question is this? Can someone help me? They were still contractors, they were still our vendor, but I wanted them to sit at our place instead of with their own company, especially since we have about 10 different vendor companies, and now they're all sitting in our building, and they can exchange information with their own team, but also exchange information with other software vendors. I hope that answers your question. And what score do you use for some of feedback from site users? I didn't actually look at that yet, but it is I will do when I return. Thank you for the suggestion. These are the questions I see on Slido. Do you have some more questions, maybe?
At least in our country, we have a very large government operate, and we can meet the situation where improvement can take a half a year. Does your team meet this challenge, and how you manage to work with this?
Yes, I recognize that change also takes a lot of time at our place. And I always tell them that time is not the most important thing, especially since we are a technical improvement. We don't have, it is not that we have to make some adjustments because of a new law that is legal from the 1st of January. We are just a technical improvement, so time is irrelevant. Just focus on quality. Focus on quality and don't make any concessions to that. Yep. No further questions? And thank you very much for your attention and enjoy your day.